Hey there. Over the past year, I've been exploring the world of particle simulations, but there was always one thing that bothered me. The fact that I had to start from scratch every single time, building the same renderer, same controls, and the same GUI over and over again. Therefore, in this video, I'll be making my own particle simulation library. To give ourselves a head start in drawing our first particle, we can borrow the Hello Triangle example from WGPU. A triangle is great and all, but that's not what we want. We want circles. Sadly, GPUs only speak triangle, and triangles and circles don't play that well together. We could just make a circle out of triangles, but this either results in a really bad circle or a waste of performance. Luckily, there's an easier solution. To understand better, we first need to look at the steps that the GPU takes to draw something. Currently, our pipeline consists of a vertex and a fragment shader. The vertex shader has the ability to modify where the vertices are, but let's first take a look at the fragment shader. Here, we dictate how every pixel's color is chosen. What we want to do is discard the pixel if it does not lie within a circle. To do this, we need to know the position of the pixel. Luckily, this is as easy as just passing the position from the vertex shader, and it will calculate the position of each pixel for us. Now we can check if the pixel is further than a distance of 1 from the origin, and if so, discard. Oh, that's not a circle. Well, luckily the fix is easy. The corners of our triangle are just too close to each other for a circle with radius 1 to fit inside, and it turns out that these corner positions work perfectly. One small note, the square root operation is quite expensive, so to avoid it, we can square both sides, removing the square root and, well, 1 squared is just 1. Under any normal circumstances, the square root would be fine, but this function could be run millions, if not billions of times per frame, so every little bit counts. Currently our vertices are in local space, or object space, meaning that they are relative to the object's position. But what if we want multiple particles? Then we need to know where every particle is, relative to the world, and how big they are. This operation brings the vertices of our particle from local space to world space. If you're trying to follow along, I suggest looking into instancing for this step. Now we've got the basics of the particles, but if we want to be able to move around and look at different parts of the world, we need to transform these world space coordinates to view space. To do this, we just need the position and scale of the view. With this operation, we can get the particles relative to the view, and scale to be smaller and closer if the view is bigger, and opposite if the view is smaller. This means that the view isn't actually getting bigger, we're just making the world smaller to make it look like it is. The final goal of the vertex shader is to bring every vertex that we want to be visible within a range of negative 1 to 1 on every axis. Right now, we just have one problem. If the height of the window is not the same as the width, the entire world gets stretched. To fix this, we need to multiply the Y component with the aspect ratio, which is just the width divided by the height of the window. This essentially brings the position from view space to clip space. Next, we need to take input from the user to be able to move the view around, and dealing with winit events is just a hassle. Therefore, I will use a crate creatively named winit input helper. It essentially just collects all the events and keeps track of the current state for you, and can therefore provide information like which buttons are being held and mouse movement deltas. Here's the code if you're interested. Now we arrive at the GUI, and to keep it simple, I just went on crates.io and I quickly found egui, a supposedly simple, fast, and highly portable immediate mode GUI for Rust, which sounds great, but of course nothing works on the first try. After the obligatory Stack Overflow visit to confirm that I'm the only one with this problem, I started my hour-long debugging journey until I finally got it working, and we can now create GUIs with buttons, sliders, and so on. Now that we have this entire library that renders circles and a GUI, we need a way for the user to choose where the circles are supposed to be rendered, and be able to react to changes in the GUI. Here's my solution. The library requires you to call one function, run, and pass in two structs which implement the simulation trait and the GUI trait respectively. Now the program hits a fork. For performance reasons, we will have a render thread and a simulation thread. This lets them run asynchronously, which means that the frame rate, or FPS, no longer depends on the so-called tick rate, or TPS of the simulation. The benefit of this is that you can move around the view at the refresh rate of your monitor, no matter if the simulation is 1 TPS or a million TPS. Another benefit is that the rendering no longer runs on the same thread as the simulation, and will therefore not slow it down. The way we accomplish this is to spin up a new thread in the run function and create the provided simulation struct in there. Then the simulation talks with the main thread, which will from now on be called the render thread, through two channels. One to send the current simulation state to the render thread, and one to send the GUI state to the simulation thread. The rest of the video will just be me messing around with a particle life simulation that I made. I won't go into the details because that's not what this video is about, but if you want to know more, there will be a link in the description. Thank you for watching, and hopefully I'll see you in the next video, where I'll start work on a Newtonian gravity simulation.